So 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. All right, folks, welcome back to the Trauma Therapist Podcast. Very excited to be here with my guest, Chantel Branch. Chantel, welcome.
Hello, and thank you.
You are welcome. You're welcome. So Chantel is a certified domestic violence and abuse specialist, survivor, mentor, and author with a background in human services and counseling. She founded My Fearless Future Project, the MFF Project, a social enterprise business offering mentorship programs and support groups to help young women in urban schools build self-confidence, self-esteem, improve decision-making skills, and heal so they can thrive. Chantel received training and certifications in domestic violence training through the State of Illinois Domestic Violence Mentoring Certification Programs at WINGS Program Incorporated, as well as sexual assault certification. Chantel, welcome to the podcast.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I'm excited to be here.
Awesome. Awesome. All right. Before we get going here, share with our listeners where you're from originally and where you are currently.
I am from Chicago, Illinois, and I currently live right outside of Chicago, Illinois. I am a self-love specialist, and I teach women how to ditch their stinking thinking through self-love and mind transformation.
Okay. All right. We'll get into that. So, well, let's get into that. How the heck did you get into this field?
I've always been in the service industry for many years. So whether it's service to the beauty industry or service to just, you know, in the human services field, serving people, serving community through church, you know. So I got into this becoming a self-love specialist as I walked through the journey of going from victim to survivor to thriver of domestic violence. And so,
the journey of victim to survivor to thriver.
To thriver, yes.
Okay. So what's the journey from victim to survivor to thriver? Talk a little bit about that journey for you.
So once you make that decision and decide to leave that abusive relationship.
Well, I want to know you personally.
Me personally. Okay. Yeah. Oh, okay. Okay. So me being a victim of domestic violence and living physically, mentally, emotionally, spiritually abusive relationship for about 3 years, it was for me a matter of life or death. It was imperative that I leave. I almost died through strangulation.
Oh my God.
On the 4th of July. And that was just the last straw. I had a few attempts to leave before that, but this time I finally made an attempt to leave. So I didn't leave that particular day, but I was out of there in the next 2 days.
How long had you been in the relationship before that, that strangulation event?
About 3 years.
Okay. Wow. Mm-hmm. Wow.
Yeah. And so of course it doesn't start off like that, because if it did, then everybody get that label. Oh, that's a, you know, crazy person, stay away from him, you know, or that, you know, woman, because it could be a woman too. Leaving, getting out of that situation. I had to go into a shelter. So I went into a women and children's domestic violence shelter.
Did you have kids at this time?
I did. I had a toddler and a 7-month-old baby. And I had to leave. I didn't want my daughters to see what I was living. I didn't want them to grow up in it. I was like, oh my goodness, I didn't grow up to meet someone and have a relationship with them. I didn't think that this would be my life. Mm-hmm. Like, what am I doing? Oh my God. And so although I had those thoughts running through my mind, it really took that moment of strangulation to say, hey, you better leave, because the next time you may not wake up.
Did you, during this time, did you have people you confided in? Were you seeking help at this time?
No.
Were you?
No, I was. I didn't believe that there was anyone that could help me. I was an active member at church, but I just didn't. So maybe now in today's more modern church, they may have pamphlets about blended families and domestic violence and sexual assault and their support groups, you know, depending on the community you go to. Mm-hmm. Whereas during that time, there was no one to help me. And I'm talking 2007, 2008, 2000, you know, so although it seems like, okay, that's not that far away and we should have those things, they weren't readily available. They weren't popping out in the community. There was no activist or advocate. I never heard of an advocate until many years later. And I decided I wanted to help women who were just like me because being in the beauty industry, having clients, you know, coming into the salon, I heard a lot of stories. I witnessed a lot of things. And so I knew it was a lot of women. Mm-hmm. You know, I was just the one that, you know, made it out, but there were so many other women, not just in my community, but all around the world, you know, all around the Chicago, you know?
So, okay. So that incident, you're like, this is, I got to get out of here. You go to a shelter. What happens next?
My life, it began to change. That is when the healing journey began. But of course, I didn't know that. And you couldn't have told me that either. I brushed it off. But that was where I began to see myself again. That was where I began to also, and I probably experienced triggers throughout the relationship, I'm sure, but know that something was happening with my body if I would see a particular car or if I would see someone that was the same build or height. Or if I would go into, you know, a neighborhood that we grew up in, you know. So, you know, later on, I realized that those were triggers. And now I can, you know, of course, identify those things. But that was something that I was dealing with. You know, women deal with PTSD or any victim of domestic violence deal with the PTSD because it was very physical.
You're in this shelter. And you kind of begin to see yourself in a different light. Do you start getting therapy? What other actions do you start to take that kind of propels you on this healing journey?
Oh, yes, I'm glad you asked. In the DV shelter, that was a requirement. So we had to go to group, and we had to go to individual. And it was hard for me in the beginning. Group helped me realize that there were many women and many different ethnicities, you know, every color of the rainbow. I realized during maybe the first 2 or 3 weeks that our stories were so similar and that we were all in this together. Mm-hmm. And I was not vocal during that time, but I listened to a lot of people's stories, and that helped me realize that and helped me understand, oh, she's going through it too. Mm-hmm. Oh, you know, and there would be stories where women would go back and that was sad. And then she would come back and the show took her, let her come back in, and she hoped that it would change, but it wouldn't. Mm-hmm. And those, because of those stories and those things that I got to see up close, because we're roommates, we're sharing, you know, food and the kitchen and bathrooms, the TV, we're sharing everything except our beds, you know, but we're sharing everything together. And those stories helped give me the strength to keep going. Mm. Because you're living in a shelter, you're like, many miles away from my house, my community, or, you know, but I still have to go to work every day in downtown Chicago. I still have to put on a happy face and serve clients, you know, in a salon. And those were the things to help me build, getting that therapy, that support. And hearing therapy helped me hear the hard truth. One question I always remember is the woman asking me, did I see it early on? And I was so offended. But as the years went past,
you're offended because What, because, was an insult to your intelligence or being?
Yes, it was like, well, of course I didn't see it in the beginning, because if I saw it in the beginning, I would have cut everything off. I wouldn't have, it would have just been a few dates, you know? It was like, oh, wait a minute, you're crazy. Or you look physically abusive. You seem like you have a very bad temper, you know, but it, and so those, that question, it really stuck with me. It stuck with me for years. And it would be probably 2 or 3 years afterwards, I was thinking back to that question and why did it bother me so much? And different memories that I suppressed and forgot about began to come back. And I remember, oh, I remember that time, maybe he did display really heavy anger through a text message, through a phone call, but because it still was the dating phase, we were living in different cities and states, it was, I brushed it off. And so therapy helped me take accountability for where I was in that relationship, you know, because you have to get to that point to realize that I allowed this for 3 years. Right. And I think a lot of people, and that's also moving from victim, because woe is me, I'm so sad, to now survivor, I'm taking accountability. I'm getting back on my feet. I'm becoming self-sufficient. And I'm making the best choices for myself and my family. And being really transparent and understanding, what does that look like for me? What kind of love do I want? What kind of health? What is a healthy relationship? How can I see that in my life? What does the next person that I enter into an intimate relationship need to have in order for me to move forward? And I need to see that, you know? And if I don't see that, I can't hope and think that it's just going to happen. I need to, you know, cut it off and move on and realize, hey, you know what? That's just those, because they don't have that, it's not going to help me continue to value myself. It's not going to help me on my healing journey, because even when I met my husband, I still was healing. And so you still walk through the journey, and it takes years. It takes time.
So this happened how many years ago?
This happened, I left, I moved into the shelter in July 2008.
About 14.
So, yeah, about, yep, 14 years.
Wow.
Yep, 14 years.
You were working at a beauty salon during this time. You continued to work at the beauty salon.
Yes.
At what point? And you said, you know, you were hurt. You were hearing stories too from other people, recognizing things. At what point, Chantel, did you say, you know what? I want to help people. I want to help people get out of this type of situation. First of all, thank you so much for sharing your story and the way you did it, I think was really helpful.
Thank you. Thank you so much. One of the things that I'm sorry, can you repeat the question?
Sure. Just at what point did you say, you know what, I want to start helping people?
Okay. I think my husband would ask me early on in our marriage, maybe 4 years after I'm out of the shelter, out of the relationship. So when he would ask me at that time, I knew that I wasn't strong enough, because I was like, oh no, people are gonna look at me. No. He would say, well, I know it's someone in the church that could listen to your story. I was like, oh, I'll pray for them. You know, but I'm not going to share my story. And maybe 6 years later, so maybe in like, I don't know, man, I'm going to say about 8 years. So I left in 2008, and January 2016, I just woke up and I was like, I want to serve. I want to help someone. I wanted to just help. I don't know. I just had a humanity heart and I wanted to help somewhere. And I kept thinking, where could I help? And I'm already serving at church and the children's ministry. And I don't want to serve in a church. I want to serve somewhere else. And I'm like, oh, I'm already serving women at the salon. And it came to me, go back, go to the shelter. And immediately I know 100% they're always going to ask you, can you share your story? And you don't have to, but if you decide to, then that just kind of takes you on a different path in your, like, I never actually got to pack bags or, welcome people in, because it took me to, just doing different events with the shelter to share my story. And that's when I knew, I was like, yeah, I knew they were going to ask me before I went. So mm-hmm. I didn't have to, get that embarrassment. And the first day of volunteers orientation, they asked me to share my story. And I did right there.
Now, we're sitting here, I could think of why maybe you wouldn't want to share your story, but what is the reason why you didn't want to share your story initially?
Shame, mm-hmm. guilt. Oh my God, she was abused. The pity eyes, the turning of their faces to not acknowledge that it was abuse. Was it really abuse? Was mm-hmm. it physical? And every victim, you carry that. That comes out with you. You're ashamed because you're staying with someone and they're physically abusing you. You're ashamed because if you have children, you are not protecting them, because you barely can protect yourself, especially if it's physically, if it's verbally or emotionally, they're still hearing those words. You're walking on eggshells. You get caught in a battered woman syndrome. You just keep staying on that cycle like a hamster, and there's nowhere to go. Nothing exciting is going to happen. It's the same new normal, waking up to a person you don't necessarily know if it's going to be a happy person, a sad mm-hmm. person. I don't know who I'm going to wake up to. And you're living on the edge. Your heart is always racing. Your throat is, for me, my throat was always dry. The hairs on the back of my neck were always raised. I was very uncomfortable. And now I put words to it. I had anxiety maybe the hour before he was to get off work. And especially like if he was on his way home, it would be like through the roof. But I didn't think of me. Oh, something's happening with my body. Oh, I'm experiencing anxiety. I probably had tons of anxiety attacks, mm-hmm. right? I probably did all of that stuff. But when he walked through the door, hi, are you hungry? And you put on his face and you just want the day to be good so that there's no pain.
So you started helping at the shelter.
Yeah.
What did you want to communicate to these, I'm guessing, all women at the shelter?
Yes.
What did you want to communicate to them? What did you want to give of yourself to them?
I wanted them to most of all see. Sometimes you just need to see it. Even if you have faith, even if you have hope, you just need to see it. And I wanted women to see what healing looks like, right? There are so many women that I have worked with that go right back to an abusive relationship. Now it's not physical anymore, but it's verbal and emotional and financial, and they find themselves gravitating back to that same, those same characteristics of the last person, not realizing that. And I really want to help women identify that. Where did that come from? Where did the feelings of unworthiness come from? Are we dealing with the past trauma that's unresolved? Mm-hmm. Why aren't you enough? Why aren't you believing you're not enough to live in a healthy relationship and not be physically hit because you are having an argument or disagreement? You don't have to yell to, get your point across. Why don't you believe that you're worthy of having a relationship like that?
So you were doing that for a while. And at what point did you say, I want to create my own business. I want to have this podcast. And just as a reminder, I'm speaking with Chantel Branch. She founded My Fearless Future Project. She also has a podcast. So when did that start for you?
So I wrote my first book. It's a fictional story, Decisions, and it's a journey of faith through a domestic violence relationship. I wrote that 2016. I published 2017, and I was so excited. And, you know, but it was very hard to get picked up by a publisher. They did not care for the topic because it did have domestic violence in it. Even though we would write the query like it's a women's fictional novel. Mm-hmm. No. And so then we went the self-published route. And there was a little traction, but not so much because of the subject line. And I mean, just if you just say the word domestic violence, people were just running from it. And I'm like, wow, this is, I was so excited. And it, so I spent like 2 or 3 years like, oh my God, this is so hard. I don't want to do this anymore. Why am I going down this journey? And then I came up with this idea because I was like, how can I get people to pay attention to domestic violence without them necessarily realizing it or mm-hmm. start and just like having conversations, right? We just want to begin. Many advocates just want to begin to have the conversations so that it becomes normal, so that we can teach our children. And I created Survivor Testimony and Monologues. It's a production, and it takes you through one day in the life of a victim through a series of 6 10-minute monologues. And we put
it's
it
like
on
a play?
In church. Yes, sort of.
Look at
yeah.
Wait, hold on. So you've got a podcast, you've got a book, you've got a, wow.
Yeah.
All right, I'm sorry to interrupt you.
No, it's
go,
okay. And
go ahead.
And so we put it on at colleges and churches locally, and we were hoping, you know, to go to the next level. And then
who performed it?
I was able to get other survivors, advocates. They're also advocates in Chicago, and they just did it. I wrote all the scripts.
Wow.
And I even reached out to, because I'm in a beauty industry and in Chicago, I do some TV and film. I also reached out to, so I met some freelance actors in addition to, and so I was able to pull them in on my projects. Wow. And I just grow community, you know, just like that. So, yeah, we hope to get that back in productions and in universities. And initially it was colleges and universities, but this year we were able to go to high schools. And I realized, oh my God, we gotta go to high schools. We need to be in high schools first. And then, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. I feel like just the youth of today, we really need to hone in, because what we discover is consent and boundaries are so blurred mm-hmm. that they believe that they, male or female, can touch the student and take their stuff, and you know, they do a lot of touching, and they do a lot of touching, but it becomes violent very fast. And so that is our focus for 2023, is teaching the healthy and unhealthy relationship workshops, and then doing the production, because the production, it grabs you, it pulls everybody's attention, because it's like watching a TV or a play. Mm-hmm. So, mm-hmm. And then we're driving in that message that they get to see it, they get to experience it, and you really feel the emotions from the characters.
So your podcast is called Identity of a Woman. Talk to us about that.
So in working with, you know, women, I believe because we're all different, we all, because of our ethnicities and nationalities and personalities and cultures and communities, we gain so many things on us, right? It helps mold us and shape us into the person that we grow up to be. And then there comes a time in your life where you have an epiphany and you say, I want to do something different. I want to look different. I want to change who I am. And then you go on that journey to personal development and self-discovery. And then you become, you know, possibly who you were created to be. And that journey you go through and take on so many identities. And that is why it's called the identity of a woman, because I had a different identity when I was in that toxic relationship. to the identity as a wife and mother for, that's a different identity. It's just uncomparable. So it's mm-hmm. like different, but where I'm still a woman, right? And so the identity of you that you take on when you become pregnant for the first time, or just pregnant anytime, right? Mm-hmm. And the identity that you, when you become someone's wife, the identity that you take on when you're in church and just your careers, it's all encompassing of who we are as women. And just like the same, it would be for men. And so I just think that that is so important, and we may forget about it or lose it because we're so focused on what social media says our identity is, or says, this is who you should be. You're most like this, so you should just be that.
Mm-hmm. You are super inspiring. I mean, not just because of everything you're doing, you know, it's like you cannot help but help other people. You go back to the shelter, you start this, these monologues, this company, this podcast, the book. It's incredible. But I think what's even more inspiring is just how you saw the beauty of your being, you know, that the true, your strength, you know, you talked about that one question that woman asked you that stuck with you, you know, did you see it before? You know, if you look back, what were some of the other things that really helped you start to find your soul, your beingness, your strength?
I think it was the environment that I intentionally began to create for myself and for my children. One of the things that many of the women, we all realized that we had in common when we lived in a shelter, was the first night we all slept peacefully. We slept so hard, we didn't even realize. I remember waking up and the sun was beaming down and I jumped up and I was like, what am I? And the sun is shining and it's quiet. And you know, it was just, and I was just taking in, okay, you're safe. And wow. So that was the thing for me, the thinking, you're safe. Wow. And so that was one of the things that I had to tell myself every time I was out of that relationship, you're safe. Or if I'm driving in a car to a grocery store, you're safe. Even a few times, I think, you know, when I was followed, I just kept telling myself, you're safe, stay calm, drive to the police station. Just get to the police station, you're safe. And so saying those words, making sure that I'm speaking positively to myself, because I heard so many negative words through those years, that even when my husband, and early on, he would always say, honey, honey, honey. And then one day I turned to him, I said, who is honey? Stop calling me honey. Because I could not, it was hard for me to accept that. And now to this, you know, now we're like, honey, I'm like, oh, honey, do this. Oh, honey, you know, honey. And getting to a place where you can accept somebody calling you something good. And believing it, like, oh, I am nice. I am a good person. I am beautiful. Hey, I do have a great smile. Because that, you know, with the emotional abuse, it really messes with your mind and you begin to think, well, maybe I'm not great. Maybe the food I cooked was nasty. Maybe I used too much salt. And you make the same meal, you know, every day, the same eggs, the same bacon, whatever you cook, right? And it's almost like you go crazy, and then the rebuilding is like undoing all that craziness that you just got out of. And then now let's deal with anything else. We've dealt with that. Let's deal with anything else. Mm-hmm. Because my biggest thing, I just want to have peace. And so I began to create an environment where I had peace, and I only had peaceful people around me. Mm-hmm. I changed my phone number. Well, the shelter was miles away out of Chicago. And so I never went back and lived in Chicago. I can go. We go to the city all the time, but I rebuilt a new life of peace.
As we close out here, what do you want to say to the listeners of this podcast who maybe themselves are going through experiencing domestic violence, wondering if it is domestic violence? What would you say to them?
I would say that there is life after abuse. After many failed attempts, I finally regained my strength and I never looked back. I tried to leave several times, but that one time, and I made it out, I never looked back. And even with the attempts of going back, don't beat yourself up. Forgive yourself and know that plan A didn't work, but plan G is gonna work. Or plan G didn't work, but plan M is next in line. And you do it until you're out. You keep pushing and believing and hoping until you're out. And there are advocates that you can reach out to. Many of my colleagues we all do different things. I have one stand-up survivor. She strategically does the safety plans so that you have so many that if one doesn't work, there's another. Let's plan it out realistically so that you can make it out safely, so that you and your children can make it out safely. And because we know what it's like when you have that financial barrier and you're dependent on this person. And so being able to get to that advocate, the National Coalition of Domestic Violence, and then also every single state has a coalition of domestic violence. There is some community, a shelter near you. They will come and get you anywhere in the United States and help you get to safety. There is help. You are not alone. And awesome. That's it.
Awesome. And what's the best way for people to contact you, Chantel?
You can head on over to your favorite place to listen to podcasts and listen to the Identity of a Woman podcast, Apple, Spotify, Google Cast, Anchor, whichever one you like. And you can also find me on Instagram at Chantel_Branch_Speaks.
Awesome. Chantel, you are amazing. I'd love to have you back at a later time. But just you're just so friggin' inspiring. I love it. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you so much. This was a great podcast. I love your voice.
Thank you.
You have that great radio voice.
I appreciate that. Take care.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.